Well, g'day everyone. We're here at Caulfield Park. Just asking people, how's life been within Melbourne? And, we're comparing that to Gippsland. Going to compare that to the country life and see, various people's opinions, getting it all down. There's a good mixed bunch of people here to get a varied, wide range of opinion, young to old, so we'll ask people as they go past and see if anyone wants to have a yarn to us. So,
what do I think about?
First let me ask you, how you been? How's your day? It's a very beautiful day. We're at Caulfield Park today.
I get along, what can you do? It's another day, and yep. It's good. It's a nice day, walking in the sun, yeah.
Exactly. Now, you see, there's a lot of people gathering, having fun on a nice day like this.
Yeah.
We now know you guys are locked down for another month.
Are we?
Yeah. I think, it's another month, Danny, but yeah. We extended it. Yeah. Just personally, how have you been coping with all this?
I personally think of it like this, that my parents went through a war. Yeah. And compared to what we go through, it's all bullshit.
Which war?
The Second World War.
The Second World
War. Because I'm in my 70s.
Yep.
So they went through a war.
Yep.
And that takes away a lot more of your restrictions and much harder. We suffer a little bit, but, it's for health reasons. And whether Dan Andrews is right or wrong or doing too much, it's all very good to know from the outside. But this is uncharted territory. He may be right or he may be wrong. But we've got to follow someone, and he probably knows more than anybody else. So, we just have to do what we have to do, and people have got bigger problems. It's hard for business. I know I had a business. I don't know how I would have run my business in this sort of climate.
Me too. We were
importing, and I don't know whether I would have... We were supplying... shoe shops and all over.
Think of the supply chains, the damage that's going on with that, the mistrust, the lack of enthusiasm in investing in Melbourne and in Victoria.
I don't know about investing. I know we lost some money because we were doing something
we couldn't invest. $1 billion a week, I think.
No, but it doesn't matter, because for some people, $100,000 is like for $1 billion for someone else.
That's the Victorian economy. Every week is about $1 billion.
Yeah, but I mean, as a business, I mean, I was an importer, so... What do? I order stuff and...
Supply and demand.
How do I control the factory in China? We had people there to look, and we couldn't send them there.
Yeah.
If I bought the stuff in, would I send the stuff out to people that hadn't paid me for six months?
Yeah.
So how in the hell...
Are you supposed to operate?
But then again, how many people are you prepared to let die before you open the economy? Say now they're losing 10 people a week. Is it okay if they lose 50 people? Is it okay if they lose 100 people? Where do you draw the line?
This is the thing, and this is where it's been blurred. It's medical science. We're not in a war, as you said. The lines for that are clear cut. Okay, it's us and them. This is a virus that's ever changing. It's ever evolving, the flu.
Nobody faced this sort of thing before here, and the government is going blind.
Yeah, of course, they scared absolutely the buggery out of everyone because they knew people are very susceptible to that.
But what are they doing if they don't? I've got a friend that daughter is a nurse at the Royal Melbourne Hospital. Yeah. They can't cope. They're turning people away.
I quit my healthcare job. I lasted about a year.
So what are you supposed to do? If the hospital get overrun, people have a heart attack, you can't get into a hospital for normal procedures. I've got a friend that just had some procedures, not life-threatening, but she had to have it delayed. And
you know what was one of the worst things? There was a birth of quintuplets in Adelaide, and this touched me quite deeply. There was a birth of quintuplets in Adelaide, and because of the COVID restrictions in the early days, they were denied emergency hospital care to Melbourne to save their lives, and they died on the way to Sydney. And we lost that miracle. And it's just these are the kind of things, people have become very desensitized to all this sort of stuff. If that happened, say, in the 90s, we'd be up in arms.
I feel sorry for Dan Andrews. Whatever he does is going to be wrong. And if he restricts the economy too much, he's wrong. If he doesn't restrict the economy enough, he's wrong. And nobody knows in advance.
It just depends you know, what element are you going to listen? What logic and reason do you want to abide by?
Look, there's and no, we, it's if a we tragedy.
See the, but if we see the data overseas, so Sweden, Denmark, you know, Europe, you've got Asia, various places, they're just opening up and they're using ivermectin, using the vaccine, they're using all, you know.
Look, the one thing Victoria's
got... They're not forcing people, that's the
main thing. Yeah, but the one thing that Victoria's got going for it is that in New South Wales they're going to open up. So let's see what happens there. Yeah. And we'll see. In 3 weeks' time, we'll know what's happened in New South Wales. If they've gone well with opening up, that's terrific.
Do you think a lot of people are going to flock over to Sydney? Sell up here and... Because there's a lot of people wanting to go overseas. Because we all know it, like Australia is like a hub. We've got a lot of ties to different countries. You know, there's a lot of mixed race people like myself, and we like to go back and forth.
Well, like I said before, if my parents and their generation went through a war, and they were in the army, and their friends were being killed, and all this sort of stuff, and their family was being killed, I mean, what are we to complain about? That we're stuck home watching Netflix and
we shouldn't be doing that.
But we
should be out. We should be out.
But I mean, I don't think we suffer that much compared to what they do.
I think if you break it down into groups, right? So you say the youth, the middle aged, and the old.
Yeah.
And then you break that down into statistics of who it affects the most, right? And then you look at why they blanket ruled and locked down everyone. It doesn't make a lot of sense. Like the youth and the middle aged, and even the old to middle aged. They should have been let free to go about keeping the economy a buoy, because at the moment it's a couple of $1 trillion in debt.
So what do you do when the kids go in and visit their grandparents or their parents and they start spreading it?
What are you going to do when our kids can't have any opportunities in 50 years, in 10 years?
Oh. I mean, what will happen to the kids if they get COVID? Nobody knows what long COVID is about anyway.
So nobody knows the long-term effect of the vaccine.
No, yeah, I know that's true, but COVID they know. It's COVID is deprivation of oxygen, right, to the organs.
Yeah.
They don't know what the effect will be in 5 years or 10 years or 20 years or 30 years.
Yeah.
So, you know, you might be doing the kids a favour to keep them out of the way. They might not suffer now, but who knows what the effect
is. There was a couple of things from California that's come out. Doctors there and GPs are spruiking. They've been coming out and saying that the kids actually break up these influenza-y cold viruses. So it's actually good to let it run its course through the youth, because they break it up.
Well, now they're saying that now.
They've always said that. They're just reiterating.
Okay, well,
because this is the
thing. How many medical opinions can
you
get?
I know. And this is the crazy thing, mate. It's like our whole medical science thing is broken down. We've got two sides of the argument pointing left and right, saying, no, I'm right. And we're stuck in the middle.
Yeah. It reminds me, I once worked as a lawyer.
Yeah.
And I was sitting there and there
was... What kind of law?
Criminal law.
Criminal, yep.
And we had a practice anyway. But when I was younger and I was sat in a case once and the jury was listening there and they had two heart specialists.
Yes.
Right? And one said this and the other one said the exact opposite.
Yeah.
How in the hell is a jury going to... How's a jury going to know who
and
to believe?
And who's to know that these experts aren't...
No, but one of them must have been right or more right. But how in the hell is a jury going to decide? So I'm listening to all this stuff coming on how in the hell do I know? I'm not a scientist.
It's like a perfect way to confuse people, because when you've got, you know, both sides with equal stature, equal experience, equal doctorates, all that sort of stuff.
Then you've got to go with the people who you think know the best, and the government's on top of it. They may be right or they may be wrong, but they know more than me, right? So that's all I can say. Anyway, thanks very much.
You too. You have a good day.
Yeah, thank you. Look after yourself, and I hope I made any sense to you.
You did. You have a good day, mate. All right, hi, how are you?
Hi, good, how are you?
Not bad. So you're out for your morning your midday exercise.
Yep.
Now, how have you been in the most lockdown city in the world?
Yeah, pretty good. Look, I'm over it, but...
Yeah, lockdown fatigue?
Definitely, yeah, absolutely. But, we have to do what we have to do to keep people safe, so I appreciate that.
And how have you found living and working and playing, still being able to sort of live your life with all the restrictions? Has it been just overwhelming in some respects? Have you been hassled by cops? Is there any day-to-day frustrations?
Yeah, look, I haven't been hassled by any cops. Yeah. probably you thought you would be, but I haven't been. I was working in travel when the pandemic hit, so
that must have sucked.
Yeah. Lost my career, so that was 9 years.
What were you doing? What role within?
I was working for Flight Centre, and I was there for years.
I had a couple of mates. Yeah, same story. Yeah. There for like ages.
Yeah, and we were just the part of the business I was in was just international travel, okay. So makes sense.
So you'd be keen to start traveling.
Yeah, without a doubt.
So did you have to adapt and overcome when you lost your job? What did you branch off into?
Yeah, look, I ended up working on one of the government hotlines, one of the COVID hotlines.
Okay. What was that like?
Oh, it was tiring. I did it for 6 months. It was very tiring.
Night shift and...
I was mostly during the day. The hotline operated from 8 a.m. until about 9 p.m. in the evening. So, 6 months doing that was very tiring. You were answering all the questions from everybody who wanted to know what the restrictions were. We were deciphering the information as it came out and just listening to people who were tired, who were losing businesses.
And I'm sure you weren't getting the long end of the stick. You were probably getting updated information and everything was proactive and you had to adapt and tell people different. Was it the same running info?
Same info. Okay. At the same time everybody else received it.
So from each lockdown it's pretty much just the same story to each person.
More or less. I mean, the restrictions changed as we went along, as the lockdowns increased.
Yeah.
But we received the same information as everybody else at exactly the same time everybody else receives it. So it was interesting, but I was tired.
So you didn't get any tip-offs? Because they don't want anyone rumouring.
Like,
yeah, because exactly. That's the weakest link in that communication, I guess.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, so you said it's good that everything's... You want to keep people safe.
Mm-hmm.
Now... Do you think that we've gone too far with everything, or do you think we're just about where we should be with the restrictions and how everything's gone?
No, look, it's never going to please everybody. Everybody's got different stories.
Yeah.
For me, I have a brother who's severely immunocompromised.
My mum too, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And
she survived. She got, she got it written down as an unknown pneumonia.
Okay.
Pre-2019, and then they said COVID was out. And I was working at a hospital at the time.
Yep.
And we all got it as well.
Oh, really?
And back then it was an unknown pneumonia.
Right, interesting.
And this is the funny thing about science,
mm-hmm.
and people's bodies and anatomy,
mm-hmm.
everyone's real different.
Yeah, very.
Real different.
You just never know how it's going to affect you.
You don't know.
Yeah.
And, do you think the blanket rulings are sort of just a bit too much when we've got stats to say, youth, young adults, 30-year-olds, 40-year-olds, 50-year-olds have a less of a perceptive chance?
It depends what you read. Because with the Delta variant, it's obviously a lot more harmful to all age groups.
And then who's to say we might not have gamma and zeta and the ever-changing variants like we had flu?
I think it's difficult because we had to do what we had to do. There's no rule book for this, really. Everybody had to, all the governments, I suppose, had to really just make it up as we go and learn from each other. So,
there seems to be two sides to this. If you look at the... Sweden and how they went, and then you look at various places in Asia, you compare that to various places in Europe, Africa, South America. There is better and worse in all of this, and I think as Westerners we've always been that beacon of logic and reason.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? And I don't know, there's just, when you talk to people from overseas, they're really, in the past couple of months especially, with what's been going on in Melbourne, people are very anxious about what's going on in Australia.
Yeah.
They feel for us, because we've been such an international, as you'd know, mm-hmm. Aussies are some of the best tourists. Like, we go around and we go everywhere.
Yeah.
And where we go, we leave that, the Aussie spirit with the people that were there, mm-hmm. Like, we leave that good custom and sometimes.
Yeah.
But those people...
Mm.
New York, in Poland, all those people that have been touched by Australia, they're coming up now and they're saying, we need to, get on with it. Poland has, and New York and other places.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think we've probably learned from that now that we know that we're opening up and we're not going back to lockdowns. We've done what we had to do. We've learned along the way. It's not something that everybody's enjoyed. I definitely haven't enjoyed it. I'm tired of it. I'm ready to go back to life, and I'm sick of waiting for life to kind of happen. But I can't do anything about the rules. I don't make them. I just have to do what we need to do, what we're told by science, by learning, by everything, and that's pretty much all I can do, really.
Yeah.
Oh, thanks.
There you go. Yeah, the thing is the science.
Yeah, well, that's,
you know,
it.
And we used to have a thing in Australia, we didn't like anything pre-digested.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? We used to like to go to the source of the root of the cause.
Mm-hmm.
And then we used to be very investigative,
mm-hmm,
in the world, especially international affairs and within our own affairs.
Mm-hmm.
We've always had that really open-ended mind, especially in science.
Mm.
And, you know, we're seeing our leaders,
mm,
use this really linear element of science. They're only picking the people that, you know, they say what they want, mm, and they're using those people only, and they're, mm-hmm, shunning any other element of science. And this is the cataclysm we've got, is, you know, ivermectin and traditional medicine versus, mm, vaccine and natural immunity,
mm,
and then human rights. It's just this, it's this crazy whirlwind of who's right in all of this. You know, who's the shining beacon that we're supposed to go to?
Yeah,
and we're all sort of at a loss.
I guess it's really who, you know.
Yeah.
World Health Organization, that's all we could go by. They're the beacon.
You reckon?
Well, that's what they do, right? They take all of the information from all pieces of science, and then that's what we go by. I trust that.
You trust the World Health
Organization? I'm not a scientist. Yeah. I can't make, yeah, decisions like that. I don't study any of these things, so, mm, I trust the people that are in those positions.
It's the trust. And it's, you know, it... We used to have a lot of social cohesion and trust.
Uh-huh.
And I just think now more than ever, with what's been going on the past, yeah, couple of years, that has degraded.
Yeah.
Like between the us and the them, and now we've got the clean and the unclean, you know, the vaxxed and the unvaxxed.
Yeah.
We've got, let's look at Sydney. It's, yeah, literally separated between blue collar and white collar.
Yeah. It's...
And that's so sad to see now, because we used to have, and I think it was because we locked down all the pubs, the churches and the bars, the gyms, because those, mm, were the meeting places to separate the divide of the classes and the divide of races and all this sort of stuff.
Mm.
Those were the places that kept everyone together. And
when
we lost
have that,
sorry?
We will have that again, though.
Yeah, we will. I'm just, one thing I'm always asking is, like, how long do you reckon it's going to take to rebuild? The people have been estimating the economy 5 to 10 years, but that atmosphere Melbourne used to have, the place to be.
Yeah.
How long do you reckon that's going to take to huck and drive again when things start to open?
No idea. Just have to wait and see.
Just have to wait.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What's it? I've just noticed your hat. What's with your hat?
My hat?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm a proud boy.
Okay.
Yeah.
Righto.
Did you know what proud boys are about?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I do. But tell me.
Yeah, just a fraternal order. Mm-hmm. With dudes, we just get together and drink.
Dudes.
Yeah, pretty much, yeah.
Yep. Okay.
No.
And what about your channel? What's your channel?
It's about? Called Hillbilly's House.
Hillbilly's House.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. But what's it about?
It's about, like, this, I go and interview, as I was saying, I'm comparing my life,
mm-hmm,
as a hillbilly out in Gippsland to people in the city, like, I'm just,
mm-hmm,
yeah.
Okay. Interesting. Cool. All right, well, good chatting to you.
All right.
Good luck with your thing.
No worries, you have a good day. There. We're out today at Caulfield Park. You're,
yes,
out for your
constitutional.
Yes, you're out for your leisure, your walk.
Yeah.
Now, I'm asking people today, how has your personal experience been within Melbourne, the most lockdown city in the world?
Yeah. Look, it's getting pretty ordinary. It's been a long haul. It's been a long haul, and I think it's affecting everyone a bit. But not a lot to complain about it in my age group,
yep,
because we haven't got jobs, we haven't got mortgages, basically, we haven't got kids to homeschool.
But is the feeling of stagnancy, like,
oh,
you're just,
look, it's definitely
sitting around
there.
And,
yeah, it's, yeah, definitely there, and I've only probably been saved largely because I have a garden.
There you go. So the garden's been keeping you.
The garden,
nice,
is important.
Well, that's a relief for a lot of us country people.
Yeah.
Is we've, like, for my three sons, for example, even though we're locked down, we're still close to the National Forest.
Yes.
So
you can still get out.
They
there.
Can still just go,
yeah,
there. And it's like, I'm upset, and that's why I'm doing this, is a lot for the kids, because I don't think it's fair that the rural kids have that advantage over the city ones. Like, they should be able to go, because there's a lot of kids who have friends. There's friendship groups between Melbourne and here, and there's family ties between their cousins and everything. And I think one thing we've lacked is just the proactiveness with the kids.
Yeah.
You know, and that's my personal thing.
Yeah.
But how do you feel in your age group watching that with the children? Have you had much engagement in that? Grandchildren or?
Not grandchildren, nephews? But friends' children.
Yep. And how have they been?
They live within the 5K and they're very little tots, so they're pretty okay. But look, I think, I mean, things are changing and you have to move with the changes, but I think initially we had to lock down, really, and it would have been much worse if we hadn't. Now, with Delta, yeah, it's a new situation.
Next year might be Zeta. And,
well, yeah, that's right. So I think until we have a high vaccination rate, it's been correct to do what we've been doing, but... It's true that everyone, even the most compliant, agreeable people like probably me, are getting a bit over it. But I do think the right approach was taken.
Federally, or state?
State. Yep. I think state. I think federally they dropped the ball. We'd be out of this now if we had the vaccines earlier.
Okay.
We'd be out of this. We wouldn't even be locked down. Okay. So they dropped the ball, but... It was the first time for everyone, so I guess that's forgivable.
Yeah, forgiveness and forgiving and forgetting, all the mistakes, on both sides, left and right, centre up and down.
Absolutely.
It has been a whirlwind of, bad times. I mean, I'd like to say we've had some wins, but, in the West, it just seems we've really dropped the ball, in terms of... just being that beacon of science and reason and logic we used to have such a firm grasp on.
Don't know that politics has ever been highly following science, or we would...
Up until now?
I think it's changing. It certainly did change during the lockdowns.
Big time.
But there's still a battle to get the federal government to follow the... basic climate change stuff. They're doing better and they're trying to move the...
Have you seen all the stuff about eco-lockdowns?
Eco-lockdowns, no.
No, so they're saying that because this was one thing they were saying in rural areas especially, where I'm from, that because of the pandemic lockdowns...
Oh, you mean the improvement in climate statistics?
Well, they're saying that because it's a lot more quieter, all the animals are coming back...
Yes, I have seen that.
All that sort of stuff. Yeah. And then they're going to use that as justification for climate lockdowns.
I don't know about that. I don't think that's going to happen.
And this is, one thing I'm sure you've learned surviving to the age you are now. I'm not saying you're old, but you've probably learnt that give them an inch, take a mile.
I think what I've learnt is that... we shouldn't be as tribal about our politics. We should be open to more discussion and discussion based on science and understanding of different peoples, where they're coming from.
All elements.
I think it's really dangerous when you get into political tribalism. That's what I've learned.
Linear thought. People that are just stuck on one path of direction.
Yeah, yep.
And this is, as I was saying, we used to not have that. We used to have, we were that beacon in the West. We had that element of logic and reason. People could trust, an Australian scientist, British, American.
That was
a standing we had. And we kept it very fiercely to ourselves because...
absolutely agree that we're not as proud of it being Australian as we were. There's the climate change thing that we're dragged our heels with. What else? We've done pretty... When you look at the world, we've done pretty well with the pandemic, really. Yeah. We have. We've done very well with the pandemic when you look at the whole world. But, there's just not that sense of pride anymore. Sense
of community too.
Well, yeah, that's hard. Anyway, I must go. My friend will...
Sorry, ma'am. You have a wonderful day. Enjoy the sun.